So this is how to build a seven-figure productized design agency. There we go. I'm Sam Rohde. So a little bit about me. I freelanced for 3 years from 2010 to 2013. Then I started a productized design agency that focused on building websites and doing marketing for attorneys. Built that until 2016, and it was acquired last year for seven figures. Now I teach productizing concepts at productized.com, and I run offsprout.com, which is a white label website building platform for design agencies. So I want to start with a story of a typical client that I had while I was freelancing, and I'm sure a lot of you will relate to this. So it's 2011, WordPress 3.2 is out, and a potential client comes to me. She says, well, I have this site, it's on a custom CMS, and I want to migrate it to WordPress. I want some e-commerce functionality, I want users to be able to submit videos, and I want to be able to, you know, okay those videos and post them. I want deep integration with the UPS API, and I also want an integration with my own software API. So it was a pretty substantial project. And we go back and forth and we exchange 40 emails, and we have 2 in-person meetings. And so finally I'm feeling comfortable enough to write the proposal and give her a quote. And so I draft the proposal. I'm thinking it's going to take 135 hours. I quote her at $4,100, which comes out to $25 an hour. So right off the bat, who thinks that I'm undercharging here? Yes, very good, I am. I was definitely undercharging. But that was the proposal that I submitted, and so that was what I was stuck with. And after that, we had another 55 emails exchanged, and I went back and I counted through all these for the purposes of this presentation. So 55 follow-up emails after that. And towards the end of that, she's talking about the budget, and she's saying that I'm charging too much. She says, so quote, I took a stab based on my lack of skill and was able to spend just 35 minutes installing WordPress and MarketPress and adding a product quickly, all while eating Thai takeout. And so the maximum I'm willing to spend is $1,600. So, I mean, besides the fact that it's amazing that somehow she figured out how to install WordPress with one hand while us normal people usually need two, she's basically putting me in a position where I have to work for $12 an hour, and I'm probably not even accurately estimating the time that it's going to take. So, you know, more like $10 an hour, if that. So, for those of you keeping score, that's... So, eventually I say, you know, I don't think that we're the right fit for you. Thank you very much, but, you know, let's part ways. So, if you're keeping score, that's 95 emails, 2 in-person meetings, 20 to 30 hours spent, and who can tell me how much revenue?
Zero,
exactly. So, not a very good hourly rate. So, at that point, I knew that I was doing something wrong. Well, actually, that's a lie. So I did that for another year, but then I finally figured out. No, it was 2 more years. 2 more years! And then I finally figured out that I was doing something wrong. And what I came to realize was I was essentially trying to run a car dealership, except every time someone was coming to me, I was trying to build their car from scratch. So I was like asking them if they wanted wheels on their car, and if they wanted 2 or 4 wheels on it, what kind of engine they wanted, if they wanted diesel or electric. And just imagine someone walking into a Tesla dealership and saying, you know what, I love Tesla cars, but why don't you throw a gas engine in that Tesla? Or, Tesla's a great brand, but I'm looking more for a Tesla plane. Could you build that for me? And of course, Tesla wouldn't build that because that's not their business model. They have a core offering. They have, you know, the core Tesla car, and then they let you customize colors, and they let you customize the look of this car, but they don't let you customize the core offering. So if they did let you do that, it would be incredibly hard to scale. But that's what we're doing as freelancers, is We're letting the customer tell us what the scope of the project is, and it makes it impossible to scale because there's nothing repeatable, and we're starting from scratch every time. So, let me take a quick temperature check right now. How many people have a WordPress freelancing, web design, web development business? Raise your hands. All right, that's a lot of you. Good. And so of those of you with a WordPress business, how many have more than 2 full-time employees? Okay, a few of you. And how many have more than 5? Yeah, so we went from, let's say, 30 hands to 3 hands to 1 hand. So it's, and you know, that's typical. It's very hard to scale a web design business. And just to drive that point home further, here are some industry statistics. So if you look at this, and you look at these two numbers specifically, so 220,000 employees and 150,000 businesses. Who thinks they know where I'm going with these numbers? Yeah?
Most of the businesses are 1 or 2 man teams.
Right, exactly. If you do the math, the average team for a web design business is 1.4 people, which means that the vast majority of businesses are just businesses with one person. So again, very hard to scale a web design business. But after my freelancing career, once I started my design agency, I started with a few key concepts in mind, and these kind of developed over time. So there's 3 of them. The first is choose a niche. So we chose the legal industry, and that served us well. The second is productize your offering. So once you have a niche, you can have a core set of features that you're offering, and you can productize that. Don't worry, I'll explain that later. And then the last one, and maybe even the most important, is maximize your recurring revenue. I wasn't paying attention at all to recurring revenue when I was freelancing. That was a huge mistake. So if you take just one thing away from this presentation, it should be concentrate on your recurring revenue. But now I'll describe all of these in a little bit more detail. So, why choose a niche? To figure out why it's beneficial to choose a niche, let's look at the customer journey. So, if let's say there's a restaurant owner, Sally restaurant owner. She sees a restaurant down the street. It's doing better than her restaurant. She's like, oh, that restaurant has a website, so I must need a website. But what does that mean? Like, she has to do research. Like, what's a responsive website? Should I be allowing reservations on the website? What's marketing? Should I be using Twitter? All that stuff. So she has to do a lot of research before she even knows what it is she needs. Next, there's the consideration phase. Once she knows what she needs, she can start figuring out who can offer these services to her and trying to choose which one she wants to go with. In the decision phase. So she's narrowed down her options, and now she has one that she thinks will do a good job, and she has to decide whether the price is right and she's ready to pull the trigger. And then finally, there's the referral page. So phase. So after you've done the contract, this part of the customer journey, the customer is evaluating whether she made the right decision, and whether she would recommend your services. So if we choose a niche, we can see that in each of these parts of the customer journey, we're at an advantage. So first, the research phase. Sally's looking through, you know, she's Googling stuff, trying to figure out what it is that she needs. Like, do I need Groupon, and do I need a website to have Groupon, and is Groupon going to be good for my business? And so you can be writing content specifically, because you're niched down in the restaurant industry. So you can be writing content specifically for her to answer all these questions, just because you're concentrated in this niche. You're speaking her language, you're helping her out. In the consideration phase, well, first of all, she already knows that you exist because she's found your website in the research phase, but in the consideration phase, you've already built trust with her because she's been like looking at asking all these questions and you're giving your answers. And she's like, okay, well, this person must really know what they're talking about. So you're building trust with her because you're able to niche down, because you're able to write this content specifically for her. Then there's the decision phase. So once you've built trust with her, it's a lot easier to make the sale, because trust is basically a function of, or sales is basically a function of trust versus price. So if the more someone trusts you, the more that you can charge that person. So again, if you're niche down, you can target them, build trust, and then it's easier to sell, and you have shorter sales cycles because you're speaking that customer's language. And then finally, the referral phase. Because you're niche down, you can productize your offering, which makes the result, your deliverables, much more repeatable, which means it's a more consistently higher quality product, which means customers are happier and more likely to refer you. So those are the advantages of niching down in every phase of the customer journey. Now, let's talk a little bit about productizing. So it's a relatively new term, so if you haven't heard of it, my definition is a productized service is a service with a well-defined scope and documented repeatable processes that minimize the skill needed to complete each process and deliver the service. So that's a mouthful, so let's break it down. So first, it has well-defined deliverables and scope, because you're dictating the scope. So remember in my story, my potential client was dictating the scope, and she asked for things like, so these are quotes, easy access to e-commerce data and freemium software download data, editorial approval for user upload videos, ability to receive quotes and generate PDF invoices. Tons of stuff. She's dictating the scope. But in a productized service, you dictate the scope. So you say, okay, we only build websites for law firms, and we know that 95% of law firm websites need this core functionality. They need practice area pages, an attorney directory that's filterable by practice area and by location. They want call tracking, monthly reporting, and they want a contact form that integrates with their CRM. 95% of all the clients that we're going after will need this core offering, and that's the scope. So if you need this functionality, we're the people that you should go with. If you need something else, something beyond that, you can refer them to a partner. So well-defined scope. Next, because you have a well-defined scope, you can start documenting your processes. So, you know, you're offering the same core set of functionality. You can break down exactly how it is that you deliver each part of that functionality, each part of the deliverables, and then document that so that later on when you start hiring, it's easy for someone to get up to speed and know how to deliver the service that you offer. And then finally, because it's well-defined, because it's documented, it's highly repeatable. And the last part, why would you want to minimize the skill needed? Well, if you minimize the skill needed, then the amount of people who can actually do these things, that can deliver these deliverables, is greater, because you know the necessary skills are decreased. And so that decreases the cost of labor. And that means it's a lot easier to find a contractor or find someone to outsource to who can deliver these things that it is that you do. And how would you go about productizing? Well, let's take a look at one step in particular, building a site. Well, actually, building a site, you can break that down into a bunch of sub-steps. So there's sending the getting started guide, recording design preferences, etc., etc. And you can document each one of these things, each one of these processes, so that it's very easy for anyone to just come on board and deliver this to your customers. And then, if we drill down, we can see that actually only two of those steps really required all that much skill, and those are the design steps. The other stuff is easy to outsource. Like, we've already documented these processes, so we can just bring on a contractor and free ourselves up to do the hard parts. So a contractor could do all this stuff and just follow the directions that we've laid out for them, like adding content, launching the site, all that stuff is documented. And further, we can drill down even to those two steps that require the skill, implementing the design and completing the revisions, and break those into sub-steps. So implementing the design is really just applying a site template and applying page templates and then customizing the design. Completing revisions is there are content revision and design revisions. And again, only two of those steps actually require skill. So only two of those steps really truly need our attention. The other steps can be outsourced to whatever contractor or can be sent to a VA in the Philippines, whoever you want. Again, it's easy for them to get on board and get up to speed because all of your processes are documented. The last part is recurring revenue. And again, if you only take one thing away from this presentation, please concentrate on recurring revenue because that's going to be the lifeblood of your business, and that's really the only way that you're going to start growing. So, to illustrate that, let's take a look at two businesses. So, both these businesses want to make $10,000 in a given month. They each sell websites for $2,500 up front, except business one doesn't charge recurring revenue, while business two does. So, if business one wants to make that $10,000, they need to build four websites. But let's say business two has 30 clients on a $100 a month plan, and then two clients on a $1,000 a month plan. They come in with a total of $5,000 a month in recurring revenue. And so, in order to make $10,000 in that month, they only need to sell two sites. So that means they need to drive half as much traffic to their website, they need to generate half as many leads, they need to close half as many sales. And that's huge. It's just, I can't stress enough how important that is to have that recurring revenue. And it also allows you to make more accurate revenue projections further into the future so you know when it's time to hire, you know when you have the money to hire someone full time. And again, if we extrapolate that over time, you can see business one just kind of oscillates around this one revenue number, kind of depending on the number of leads that business one generates. But business two, their revenue is going up month over month. Even if their leads oscillate, if the number of sales that they close oscillates, their revenue is still going up month after month because they're stacking recurring revenue on top of each other. So month after month, they're making more money. And you might say, okay, well, that's great. You know, if my clients would pay for something recurring, would pay ongoing, then that would be great, but they don't. But I'm telling you that if you frame it right, your clients will pay something ongoing, whether it's $50, $100, $200, that you'll have to figure out. But if you're serving businesses that make money, they will be able to afford some sort of monthly recurring fee. And so what you're charging for, you can be charging for hosting, you can just set up your own WP Engine account and then put all of your clients on there, and then you're the intermediary whenever there's a hosting issue. This is a big one, customer support. So you can say, look, I know that a couple months down the road, you're gonna wanna change your website, and this is a number that you can call. You don't have to go out and try and find another freelancer. I'm not like giving you your website and then sending you on your way. I'm here for you. Here's my number. Just give me a call. And in exchange for that, all you have to do is pay $50 a month, $100 a month. So that peace of mind is huge. Another thing you can charge for is reporting and analytics. And there are a number of companies out there that you can use to send automated monthly reports so that the amount of work that you have to do is zero. All you have to do is just set it up, link their analytics account, and then this is a value add and another item that you can say you're charging monthly for. Then there's ongoing platform improvements. If you host all of your clients on a multi-site or something, and you're updating that multi-site consistently, making it faster, adding plugins, whatever. You can be charging for ongoing platform improvements. And then finally, there's marketing services. So that one's obvious, SEO, PPC, social media, all those are things that you could be charging monthly for. So when we started, here is what our design agency looked like. We were building cars from scratch. But by the end, when we put together choosing a niche, when we productize our offering, when we start charging recurring revenue, our business starts to look more like this. So it's an assembly line, and maybe it's not romantic, but it's efficient. You have your core offering, your core car that has all the functionality that your clients need, and then you allow them to customize colors, to customize the interior, to choose their rims. They're customizing the art, the superficial stuff. But you have a core offering that you know your clients, you know will serve your clients. And that's how you can scale, and that's how you can build a seven-figure productized design agency. And that's all I have, but I'm happy to take questions now.
So how long did it take you to bridge into the productized space where you read all the documentation, you find all of your procedures? Was that over the course of a year? And were you able to sell during that time? Or was it something that you had to stop everything and focus on all the documentation and procedures?
Yeah, so in case you didn't hear, the question was how long did it take to convert into a productized agency, and kind of what was that process? So when we started the design agency, it wasn't, I don't even think that I knew the term at that point. So that term kind of gave me a way to organize my thoughts. So it definitely evolved over time. But we were already documenting our procedures. We had already chosen a niche, and it wasn't like we needed to document everything first and then we could, you know, start serving clients. We developed that documentation over time. You know, when we were going to bring on a new freelancer, we would make sure that things that freelancer was going to do were all documented, so that as soon as that freelancer was hired, we could onboard the freelancer really quickly. So it kind of evolves over time, and you can do it organically. It's not like an all or nothing sort of thing.
Yeah, I have a question. So how do you go about establishing legal contracts between you and your clients? Do you use a lawyer? Is there some standard contracts that can be used in this business? Can you speak to that a little bit?
Yeah, so the question is about how do we establish contracts with our clients? So actually my co-founder is an attorney, so he drafted the original contract, and I'm sorry if that's not helpful. But there are a lot of like form contracts that you can find on the internet. If you have some web designer friends, they probably have a contract that you can use as a baseline. And maybe pay an attorney a couple hundred dollars to, you know, tweak that contract to your liking. Another good thing about being in a niche is that contract can be the same for every client, because you're basically delivering the same thing for each client. And then you can kind of evolve that contract over time if you need to. In fact, we did. When we started, we said that we would allow 5 changes per month, and we changed that to 2 changes per month. And what we classified as a change was any email or phone call. So there could actually be a ton of changes in that email or phone call. But we would limit the amount of messages that a client could send us per month. And so that's the one change that we would make to our contract. Does that answer your question?
Yeah.
Okay, so you listed the tasks for completing the website itself and how to simplify that. But how would you go about, how do you guys handle project management, like freelancers and other tasks and make sure the task is completed on time?
Yeah, so the question is about our project management process. So for a while, we just used Trello and a company called Process Street. That's what we use to document all of our processes. So Process Street allows you to like basically have a checklist and assign that checklist to a contractor. So we would say, okay, you're working on this project. Here's the checklist for building the website for this client. Just go through this checklist, check things off as you go. And then once they're finished, it sends us a message saying, oh, you know, your freelancer has finished all this stuff. And then in Trello, we could move the card, but you know, we had Kanban style, so you move it from like ready to design to in the process of designing to waiting for a client feedback. And so we, you know, our Trello board evolved over time. But there's actually, let's see, where am I? So I have a course, and if you use that coupon code, it's free. So if you go to productize.com and just follow the link, that coupon code will get you the course for free. And I have a downloadable that is our full process and our full project management board. So if you're interested in learning more about that, you can download these resources, and it has basically a full cheat sheet for you.
So you get the client signed up, you know, they're totally on board with the fact that everything is within the scope, and then towards the end they try to throw something in, oh, we just thought of this. How do you handle that? You just say, this is not part of the overall plan, or you say, well, we can handle that maybe after the project is launched and we'll bring in somebody specifically to do that. How do you address those issues? Like everybody's very on their best behavior about to sign the contract, and then somewhere in the middle, they start to introduce little things.
Yeah, that's a good question. So the question is, how do you address scope creep when clients aren't cooperative after?
No charging.
I don't even know. It's a hard thing to describe without a charging. It's a very good question, and 90% of the time, we were able to convince someone that what they were asking for was not necessary, because we knew that the results that we were delivering for clients were good results. And so we said, you know, like, if you really want this slider to, you know, have a 3D transform, then, you know, it's not going to help you. It's actually probably going to hurt your conversions. And so we really recommend against it. And that worked most of the time. When it didn't work, we would say, okay, well, let's get this launched. Like you said, let's get this launched, and then we can address it. And then most of the time, the client would just kind of let it lie. And for a few clients, so there the one or two outliers, one, I think there's probably one or two where we eventually parted ways, or they said, you know what, we really need this, and so we're going to go to someone else because we said, you know, this is not something that we offered, it wasn't part of the original scope. And so they said, you know what, we're going to leave. And at that point, you know, they had paid the upfront, but we wouldn't lock them into a long-term contract. And you know, so it's not an ideal situation by any means, but that happens. And there were one or two where we developed the features for the client, and I regret doing that because business, and we were instead just working inside the business. I think there's a question all the way at the back.
Do you think that productizing is something that can work for other WordPress-related creative businesses, such as content creation? So I did why I'm asking.
Such as what?
Content creation.
Content creation, yeah. So the guy who I learned a lot of my productizing concepts from is a guy named Brian Castle, C-A-S-E-L. And he has a productized content agency called Audience Ops. So I'm not sure what his procedures look like. I don't think he shares that publicly. But I know that he's done it, and I assume that it's you're basically just trying to figure out exactly what it is. Like, it's the process isn't just write an article. It's like, who do you reach out to? How do you know what to write about? What is that? What is the framework for that article? Like, what does the intro look like? What does the body look like? What do you need to include? How many links? All that stuff is stuff that you can document in your process.
Great. Thank you.
Yeah.
Wait, please.
Talk
about reporting and analytics. Automated?
Can
you recommend a particular?
Yeah, automated reporting and analytics. I think we were using Raven tools for SEO, and I think that my old company just transitioned to a new service now. I'm sorry, I don't know the name. I can probably find it out for you after if you want to talk to me after, and I'll ask my co-founder.
Back here.
How much do you charge for platform improvements?
Sorry?
Platform improvements, like plugins and things like that.
Yeah, so those were all things, if we go back. So these are all things that you can say are rolled into your monthly fee. So, I mean, with maybe the exception of marketing services, you can say, like, look at all these things that you're getting. You're getting your hosting, your security, your backups, you're getting customer support, you're getting reporting and analytics, you're getting ongoing platform improvements, and all it's costing you is $100. And so when you, like, badger your prospects with all of these things that they're getting, eventually they're like, okay, I see the value that you're providing. Here's my $50 a month, or here's my $100 a month, depending on your market.
So all of them.
Yeah, so all that. Besides marketing. Marketing is separate because it involves a lot more work, so you know, if it's SEO, that might be a separate $1,000 fee or $2,000 fee. Unless, and this is another pricing strategy that you can use, for a productized agency, you can require that someone has a marketing service as part of the plan. So you can say, look, we only work with businesses that are really focused on growing their business. And we know that requires $2,000 a month of SEO work, because we're gonna have to go out and we're gonna have to build links for you. We're gonna get all of your directory listings done for you. Outreach, PR, and all that stuff, and our minimum commitment is $2,000 a month, because we only work with agency or businesses that are serious about growth.
You went from a startup to selling your business to 7 figures in a very short amount of time. I'm wondering that when you were first starting out and first creating that business, what were some ways in which you found your initial clients?
Yeah, how did we find our initial clients? So the first thing that we did, again, my co-founder is an attorney, and I recommend choosing a niche where you have some sort of connection, or you know, some sort of in. But we took on 3 clients for free, and we just said, look, we're going to build your website. We need to build our portfolio. So we literally started from scratch. I didn't use anything from my freelancing career. We were starting from scratch. So we got 3 people, We got three people who were willing to let us build them a website for free. We put that in our portfolio, and that was, you know, we had now had a portfolio page that said a selection from our portfolio with three sites on it. So that was how we got the first three, and with that, we were able to then, you know, as we were driving leads, and that was primarily through content creation, like I was saying. Content creation got us pretty much to the point where we were when we were acquired. We were starting to use some other methods. But it took us about 6 months of writing blog posts every week, and it sucks because for 6 months you're not really driving traffic, and then all of a sudden it starts pouring in, but then you have your portfolio from the three people that were gracious enough to let you do free work from them, and you can start converting this traffic that you're driving from your content marketing. Any more?
What kind of entity purchased you? A larger agency or?
What's the question again? Sorry.
What kind of entity purchased you? Was it another agency or another kind of company?
Oh, the company that acquired us. Yeah, that's another thing. It's another benefit of being in a niche is that there are other companies in that space. So the company that bought us was a company called Uptime Legal. They had private cloud software, and they were getting asked by their clients to build them websites, and so we had a partnership where we were like exchanging leads back and forth, and finally they were like, you know, why don't we just buy you instead of trying to build our own, or instead of referring traffic to you. But that was only possible because we were focused on a very specific niche. If we weren't focused on a niche, if we were a generalist, I think that the potential list of acquirers would shrink drastically. It's basically just a bigger agency is the only kind of company that's interested in buying smaller general agencies.
Yeah, so I have like two questions, I guess. So first of all is, for a beginner agency, you know what you're capable of doing, but you're like, sometimes you have like a lot of, let's say, talents in your team, but you don't know what is like limited down to what you actually want to focus on. So do you select what you want to focus on depend on market or depend on what you actually can do?
Good question. I think even if you do have a lot of talents, you're probably better at one or two things than you are at the rest of them. Even if you can do them, like Elon Musk probably can build a Tesla plane. I mean, he builds rockets, so he can do it, but he thinks that his talents are best served building electric cars. So I would focus on the things that are truly your best talents. Sorry, what was the second half of the question?
Or also like, it really depends on the market, I guess. Because, for example, one of my friends, he said, oh, I can build apps, I can build like, software, but he really don't know what is outside the market.
Yeah.
So do you think that would be best for, like, we did the market research first and see what is the market actually needs, and depend on the research, and then we decide what to move on with, what our services.
Yeah. So it's also about what you enjoy most. I mean, if this is a business that you're going to be working on for the next 3 years, 5 years, 10 years, what kind of projects do you enjoy most? Is it, if it's making apps, then I would just focus on, you know, making apps, and you probably even at this point want to find a niche within making apps. Like, is it making workout apps, or is it making like simple apps, or very complex apps that use Google Maps, or you know, whatever it is, it should be something that you enjoy, something that you're good at, and then just find a large enough niche that has customers that you can serve well. All right, I think that's it. Thanks, guys.